myself. There is no gain worth the commerce of self. Wouldn't you rather live from the heart? A life that will matter to be lived from the start. Yeah. May you hear every word. Don't sacrifice meaning for riches that burn. Wouldn't you rather live from the heart? A life that will matter to be lived from the start. Oh, all of these lessons I've learned for myself. There is no gain worth the commerce of self. A dream left for dead. Now a nightmare that feels like hell.
So guys, we got to hear Wouldn't You Rather there from your upcoming new CD, which we can't wait to hear when it comes out finally. Just to kick things off a little bit, we are in this very special room, Jimi Hendrix bedroom. Just what's your sort of thoughts about Jimmy, and also the fact that it's sort of like, you know, 50 years on or more since he sort of impacted on the scene, but yet it still has this lasting influence. What's your take on that?
You know, he's just one of those guys. As a guitar player, when I was a kid, everybody just put him up as the best guitar player who's ever lived. You know, so it's always that. I was a little intimidated by Jimmy when I was a kid. I couldn't do it. I was more of a metal guy. But I think as you grow older, you appreciate him more and how much he influenced so many guitar players. And he'll go down on every top guitar player list, especially influentially.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, the weight that he brought to the whole scene. I think in a lot of ways, it feels like as a guitar player, I don't know if it's ever been matched. It seems like you read about how artists from the Beatles to Clapton and all these guys, when he first burst on the scene, I mean, imagine how heavy that was. he was doing something that was. It was like it was from outer space, you know, who's this guy and where's this coming from? Yeah, so the effect that he's had on music 50 years later, you can still feel it, you can still hear it. I actually had the opportunity to see Gary Clark Jr. about a week ago, and, you know, hearing him and hearing how he's, you can hear, you know, Jimmy's, you know, weaving in and out through that as well. And so many, I mean, I can't tell you how many licks I use in my leads that are straight up Jimmy licks that I learned, you know, a long time ago as a kid sitting in my bedroom. So he's had a profound effect on music.
Well, he seems to be the sort of player that when you first hear him, you're like, oh, wow, this guy's the best ever. And then you hear other guys, and then you kind of forget, like, you put him to the back a little bit. But then as you get older and older, you realize it was always Jimmy all the time.
Yeah.
Wasn't, you know?
Yeah, that's true.
It's a strange one. So Walk the Sky, fantastic record. We've got to hear it. We're lucky that we're hearing it ahead of fans. But we're really stoked for the fans to finally hear this one. You've got to be excited about it too. How excited are you about this album coming out finally?
Very excited. You know, it's tough to record a record, be done with mixing and mastering, have to wait 3 or 4 months to get it out. So we're patiently waiting. Can't wait for people to hear it. All the feedback we've gotten so far has been tremendous, and can't wait to go out there and tour on it.
For sure.
What he said.
Yeah. And, you know, as I said, it is a killer record. Heavy is, you know, something you expect from Altar Bridge, but there's also some almost little electronic sort of vibes going on in there as well with, you know, Godspeed, etc. When did that sort of creep its way in into the writing process?
Something that we discussed pretty early on as far as a flavor that we wanted to add into the mix. Mark discovered a record by a band called Gunship. Yep. That he really liked, and I'd watched the Stranger Things series with my wife, and I remember thinking, man, I really like, it made me miss the sounds from the 80s in terms of, especially like John Carpenter films and the eerie element of, you know, some of the synth uses back then. So we talked and thought about integrating some of that into our sound. So it's a delicate balance as a band that's known for being, you know, predominantly riff-oriented, guitar-oriented, to add that into the equation. You gotta be careful because you can you can go too far. So I feel like we did a pretty decent job of balancing what we're known for with this new element that helps define this record.
Well, something you guys do incredibly well is bringing some pop sensibilities to heavier music. You know, Mark's always done this, but the pair of you have always done this in various projects. You know, is there anything that's sometimes where it's on that line where you're like, oh, I don't know whether we can put this out, that people are going to say this is a pop song, and anything that you've sort of changed your mind on putting it on the record, even though it was a great tune?
Not on this record. You know, there's, you know, some of the, sometimes we have songs that we might push to our solo records, or maybe think to put on the back burner for another artist, maybe write with somebody or something. But for the most part, if you have a real emotional song, you just put an Altar Bridge spin on it. And if you feel good about it, you just roll with it, you know. And we don't put anything out that we're embarrassed of, or else we just erase it if we're embarrassed of it.
There are plenty of live performances I could point you to, though, that are plenty embarrassing.
Now, what about in terms of the gear that you guys have been using? Because obviously it's always fantastic tones on the records as well all throughout. Any new toys that you used on this one?
Yeah, actually for me, the big, from an amp perspective, I used Diesel VH4 a lot more. Normally I've been a Herbert guy, but used a lot more of the VH4 on this. And also there's a product that Universal Audio makes called the Aux, which is I don't even think I used a cabinet at all on this record. It's all just going out of the amp right into the Aux, which is like basically a cabinet simulator on steroids. And so those were some of the new toys that I messed with on this record. How about you?
I used a lot of my signature amp on this album. The Cornford RK100 is a staple in my tone for live. Not for live. Fender Twins for clean, along with my SIG amp. And then a Mesa Boogie rectifier every now and then. You know, I kind of leaned more heavily on the SIG amp. But I'm still a believer in amps and tubes, and I don't like to do the digital thing as much as a lot of people these days. I'm trying to hold on as long as I can.
For sure. I mean, last time we spoke, Mark, it was just before your show in London, your solo show, and we had a little chat off camera about Victory, you know, because obviously you've got that history with Cornford, and now that's kind of, there's that nice through line with Victory. You tried out any of those amps? What's your take on them?
Yeah, the V40 or the Duchess was the clean tones off of my last solo record. And I had brought in so many amps this time. I think we might have brought that in for some of the clean tones on this record too. But they make some beautiful amps. They're, you know, I've got four Victory amps, and they all do their thing. Especially that V40 was probably my favorite.
But there's something about those Cornfords, though, isn't there? That's
the Cornford RK100 to me, especially the one I have. You know, I played another one that I liked. I thought it was great, and that's why I wanted one. But when I got mine, everybody's like, "Is this amp that much better than this one, or is it just me?" And I agree, it's a magical amp. I think a lot of people would be surprised if you took out just one 12AX7 and replaced it with the next one in the box. It's a completely different sounding amp. So whatever combination I've got going on with that amp right now is special.
Fantastic. Now, both you guys, although today you're playing two fantastic Taylors, you've obviously got a long relationship with PRS as well. Now, something I haven't asked Mark in the past, we have talked a lot about PRS and obviously signature amps and stuff else. I haven't had a chance to ask you about it, but something I would like to ask you both is, what is your recollection of your first sort of dealings with PRS and Paul in particular? Was it a good experience?
Yeah, mine was back in around 2000, I think. They kept on asking, you know, do you want to try one of our guitars? And I said, of course. It was a guitar. I had spent pretty much every penny I had on a PRS before this, so I wish they would have talked to me before that. But I got the guitar, loved it, played it on stage, and the knobs were all in the wrong spots. You know, I grew up with a Les Paul setup. And so we're like, all right, I can't use this guitar. They're like, all right, what about we send you this McCarty with the knobs down here and the switch up here. And they sent it to me, and the tone just wasn't quite right. It felt great. I still have that guitar. It's one of my favorite guitars ever, but it's just not the heavier sound that I'm looking for. So they sent me a guitar with Dragon 2 pickups and tried. Finally, they said, why don't you just do what you want to do? Let's design a signature model for you. And I, at that time, it was only Carlos Santana and myself, and I was honored. And when I met Paul, Paul's just like this 13-year-old brilliant mad scientist guy that all he cares about is technology and guitars and amplifiers. And he's like, who's the doctor from Back to the Future?
Yeah, I was just thinking the same thing.
Yeah.
Doc. They just called him Doc. Yeah.
He's like Doc from Back to the Future. That's him. But he's got a lot of passion.
For sure. And yourself, Myles?
Yeah, I mean, my first experience with a PRS guitar, I kind of inherited it because I had a manager. I was playing in a band called the Mayfield Four, and we had a gig at CBGB's when it was still open doing music back in New York. And he just got this McCarty. He was so happy with it. He's like, hey, you want to use it for the show tonight? And I'm like, yeah, absolutely. So we do the show. And at the end of the show, I'd always do the Pete Townsend windmill thing, and I was wearing some rings. And I wasn't really thinking about it. I was just getting all crazy. Rock. Take the guitar back to my hotel room to clean it up and give it back to my manager the next day. And I open the case and I realize it's a brand new 10 top McCarty, and there are dings all over the top of it for my rings. So I get to the van the next morning, and I'm literally just have to write him a check. Like, I'm buying this guitar from you because you're not going to want this back. And so we made the trade, and so that was the first PRS that I got, and I'm glad because I still use it. Actually, that's the guitar I use on Open Your Eyes Live, the red one. And but the first time I met Paul years later, that's exactly what I thought. He was like this passionate mad scientist. And to this day, he'll still reach out and be like, oh, I've got this. I'm just going to send you this amp. You got to check out this. And he's so excited. Every new thing that he's working on is the best thing. You know, he hasn't been affected by, you know, decades and decades of creating new instruments and kind of getting lazy. I feel like he's still trying to strive for that, whatever it is. And that's very inspiring.
Absolutely. And Myles, obviously, you're a phenomenal guitar player yourself. You've... you know, you've got a long history of playing the instrument. You know, you don't have to search too far back to see even videos from, you know, 1990 and, you know, very early days where you're up shredding away on the guitar. You are predominantly known as, you know, a lead vocalist, although you do obviously play guitar for every project that you're in. Have you ever struggled with that, the identity of that, where it's kind of like people expect you to be one thing, but you're actually a kind of multifaceted musician?
That's an interesting question, because I do probably love the guitar the most. I love singing, don't get me wrong. I get off on it, but guitar rules, you know, and it's still, that's what I spend most of my time doing, is trying to get better on the instrument. If I'm not performing, I'm in a hotel room, trying to get better on lead, you know, with my leads. And the thing about spending all this time working on lead guitar skills when you play in a band with Mark Tremonti and when you play in a band with Slash, it's like, well, you're wasting your time, bro. It's like, but I just love it.
What are you talking about?
I love guitar is awesome, right?
Well, you see, that's the thing. You know, everyone that you do play with, they're all like, no, this guy's just pretending to be humble. You know, like everyone knows you're a killer player, but you probably have to be a little bit more restricted because you've got, well, there's rules in a band, isn't there?
Well, yeah.
Not in Alter Bridge. You know, I think from day one, I think Myles kind of took the stance of, I'm the singer, I don't want to step on any toes. And I think I like to credit myself with being like, dude, do this. You're so good. Do it. Now it's everybody knows, you know, everybody knows how good Myles is because he's done every record. He does his share of solos, you know. It's not a type of band where I'm the lead guitar player, your rhythm.
Yeah, no, that's
stepping on my toes.
He has been. That's true. And I like to think the same thing about his vocal skills. I was like, push him to do more vocals. So, yeah, I think that we both respect one another. In the sense that we see that we've got a few different things we love to do, and we want the other guy to do that, which is great because I think that
it's just a secret weapon within a band. I remember watching when I was a kid, I watched Queensryche play live, and one guy did a guitar solo, then the other guy did. I'm like, no way, a band has two lead guitar players? That's the most amazing thing in the world. Why, you know, a guy is more than capable of being a lead guitar player in any band, sit there and not do it because somebody else has the title. And there's two lead guitar players in Alter Bridge, you know.
Awesome. Well, it's good to hear that it's official. That's for sure. So, with obviously you're back doing the day job, Alter Bridge. We can't wait for, you know, you guys to get back here and play live. And we're going to talk a little bit about that in just a second. But obviously, you guys have tons of other projects as well that you do. You're probably the most busiest people in rock and roll. Out of the other projects that you guys have done, which is the favorite of each of yours, you know, from your past? Like, is there something, Myles, that you just love that Mark's done and vice versa?
Yeah, actually, the first track on your latest record, Bringer of War.
Yeah.
The chorus on Bringer of War is one of my favorite.
Oh, sweet.
That chorus, like the first time I was on a plane and I had just gotten the copy of it and I was listening, dun, 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 and that chorus kicked in and I was just like, whoa,
nice.
That's massive. That might be like, and he's really good with choruses, and that might be one of my favorite ones.
Thank you.
Yeah.
I think, is it Love Can Only Heal? Is that the title of?
Yeah.
I remember listening to his, I was one of the first people in the world to get to hear his solo record. You know, we just woke up on the bus, we were in Europe somewhere, and he played it for me, and every song was, you know, I kept on saying, well, maybe that could be the single as it goes on, and then it came, that song came along, and that's my favorite song off his solo record. And there's been stuff over the years where, you know, sometimes I'm sure it happens with him too, where you'll hear one of us in the back lounge singing something's like, oh, is that for our next record? No, damn it, you know, staring in the sun or whatever it is that he's singing in the back lounge. I'll be like, come on, man, save it. But you can't save stuff for the following record after record. You got to put out whatever you got best going on at the moment, so we understand.
For sure. Now, this is going to be a massive record, obviously, but when you think about over the past couple of decades, there aren't too many massive rock records, really, you know, like that are happening. You know, people are super stoked for this, we're excited about the Tool record, etc. But when you think back to like 20 years ago when you did Human Clay, that in some ways kind of feels like one of the last massive rock records. How do you feel about rock as it is right now? And are you optimistic about the future?
Yeah, I think from what I'm seeing and what people are telling me, rock is trending upwards right now. You know, there was a time where everybody's raining on the rock and roll parade, saying rock and roll was dead, this and that. And I came out in the public and said, you know, Gene Simmons had said something, and of course I said, no, it's not Gene. Rock and roll is not dead. And I, you know, as long as there's guys like all of us in this room believing in it, it's going to continue. I know in the United States, radio spins for rock and roll have been going way up. pop songs, you hear the guitar solo more, you know, little bits here and there. You have pop stars that are big rock fans that come out in the press, and hopefully there's going to take another Guns N' Roses style band to come shake things up to get us back on track.
Yeah. But I do feel like with the really young kids, I feel like the rock thing is kind of coming back. And, you know, we just did a tour with Slash and the Conspirators, and there's this young band called Dirty Honey, and I'd be listening to them play, and I'm like, man, this is like old Aerosmith and a bunch of different things that I grew up listening to. And then I went out and watched them. I'm like, these are really, you know, young guys. And it's, so it's awesome to see, and you're seeing more and more of that. So I don't know, man. I think we're going to see some cool stuff continue to evolve. As long as you still have young people that are jonesing to, you know, to jump on the blues-based rock trip, I'm very optimistic.
Would we ever see anything from the Mayfield Four again, you think?
It'd be tough to juggle four bands. I think once we get this cloning thing down, then maybe we can, you know...
Cool. What about five with Citizen Swing?
Oh, well, I don't know if that's ever going to happen. But
yeah, there's a lot. There's a fantastic resume that's there for sure. Now, you guys are just about to play with another band that have got a fantastic resume in the UK, Shinedown and Seven Dust as well. I mean, what a lineup this is going to be for the UK. Just tell us a little bit about how that tour came about and your thoughts on those bands in particular.
You know, we can't forget about the Raven Age. We're good friends years, you know. But whenever we come over to do these big European tours, it's always important to find a partner, the touring partner. And we've had some killer ones over the years. And, you know, Gojira, and we've had Volbeat. We've had lots of great bands. And Shinedown did it with us. Hailstorm. And, Blackstone Cherry. But Shinedown did it with us, and it went well. And when we were teeing up for this tour, there was a few names in the... that were going around, and you know, a lot of times, of course, the band gets the final say on it, but also the promoters and managers and record labels saying this is what's going to work best, you know, and you want to do right by the people that are believing in you and your tour. So you know, we're friends with the Shinedown guys. We think they do a great job. In the United States, they just set a record, I think, for most number one consecutive singles at rock radio. A massive amount of singles. I don't know what it was, but we're looking forward to it. And I know a lot of the UK fans and European fans in general want to see this happen again. Yeah. Seven Dust. Sorry, I don't want to skip on Seven Dust. One of our
Force
best
of nature.
Friends in the whole business. I've probably done more shows with Seven Dust than any other band. They're a terrifying band to follow if you don't know what you're doing, because they kill it live. If you haven't seen Seven Dust, you're going
to
be blown away.
Well, that's in the UK. We don't get to see them too often, but, you know, everyone will be at that show, that's for sure. Now, final thing, because I know you guys need to go. Talking about great shows, last time we got to see you was at Download. Incredible, killer show that you guys did. Thoughts on that festival? It's clearly very special to you.
Yeah. I mean, that for me, I don't know about for you guys, but that was the first, like, real big festival that we did back in 2005. And I'll never forget, like, warming up in the bus, you know, going, oh, geez, this is, you know, there's going to be like 80,000 people in there. I'd never played to that many people. I was totally freaked out. And it ended up being an amazing experience. But to have had the opportunity to go back as many times as we have, now it feels very, it's like a party with 100,000 of your closest friends, you know. It just feels good. It feels... I don't know, but it's still really special, and it's pretty much the festival in Europe, you know. So,
killer. Best of luck with the new album, guys.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.